within the hustle and bustle of a megalopolis like Mumbai. The old world charm still pervades at Colaba. And the rich legacy this observatory and Alibag has amassed over the last two centuries inspires geomagnetists globally. The scientific and historical significance of the dual magnetic observatory remains unmatched. Scientists have been lured and charmed by a simple magnet's ability to penetratingly probe the interior of the Earth, Sun, and the intervening space between the two. Let's see how the humble magnet is helping us to demystify the cosmos. The Chinese were the first to realize the directional property of magnets, and later the discovery of inclination by Robert Norman in 1576 revealed that magnets behave differently at different places. The diagnostic property of the magnetic needle was explained by William Gilbert in the year 1600 in his remarkable book De Magnete, in which he declared that the Earth itself was a gigantic magnet. It was also noticed that the Earth's magnetic poles kept changing their direction with respect to the geographic poles. The angle between the two came to be defined as declination. Compass users, ignorant of this angle, strayed from the trodden path, forcing Edmund Halley to carry out the first declination survey of the Atlantic Ocean in 1701. Did the Arabian Sea and the Indian subcontinent exhibit magnetic changes? The savants of the day from British royalty earnestly embarked on this mission. Let us now go to 19th century Bombay that was spread across seven islands and was a major port city of the British. Hence, Colaba was chosen as the location for the meteorological observatory in 1823. The observatory kept time and collected weather data for maritime trade. The British royalty also planned to establish a magnetic observatory at Aden in Yemen.
I think it's to the good fortune of the Indian community that for some reasons beyond the control of the royalty, this observatory got shifted to Colaba. Since then, as most of the weather bulletins were being issued from this observatory came to be known as Colaba Weather Observatory for a very long time, until the arrival of our great Indian scientist, geomagnetist, called Dr. Nanabai Moose.
The first magnetic observations at Colaba were taken in 1841 and continued for long. However, in the year 1900, a proposal to introduce electric trams in place of horse-driven trams in Colaba threatened the accuracy of the magnetic recordings. To ensure the continuity of the recordings, an alternate place with the same magnetic conditions as Colaba had to be found. This was done under the stewardship of Dr. Moose, the first Indian director who homed in on Alibag and insisted on simultaneous readings at Colaba and Alibag.
They quickly realized by the year 1906 that the recordings are near identical, and hence it's possible that the Colaba observatory could be shut down and then the operations could shift to Alibag for eternity.
In 1971, the Government of India granted autonomous status to the Colaba Alibag Observatory, renaming it the Indian Institute of Geomagnetism, with the mandate to conduct research in geomagnetism and allied areas. The Indian Institute of Geomagnetism, or IIG, an autonomous institute under Department of Science and Technology, inherited the legacy bequeathed to it by the Colaba Alibag Observatories. But how and when did the geomagnetic force come into being? Let's start from the very beginning. Earth at birth was a gaseous blob comprising many elements and compounds. As it began to cool, it settled into different layers, each with a different composition, each layer at a different temperature and pressure. As the Earth rotated around its axis and around the Sun, these layers spun too, but at different rates. The movement of the electrons at the core mental boundary created an electric field, which in turn gave rise to a magnetic field. This rotating current formed a dynamo and began to exert a magnetic force. This is the geodynamo, and like other magnets we are familiar with, it has a magnetic north and south pole. It exerts a force field that varies over time and distance from the poles to the equator. The magnetic field lines enveloping the Earth would have been perfectly symmetrical had the Sun not exerted its influence on these field lines. The charged particles squeeze the field lines from one side and extend it on the other side.
Millions of tons of matter is ejected from the Sun. This is called coronal mass ejection. Some of this, you know, can travel towards the Earth. And this is a huge amount covering a lot of space, and this can really engulf the Earth. And what protects the Earth from all this highly energetic particles is, of course, the Earth's magnetic field.
Just like the Earth, the atmosphere also has different layers dynamically coupled with one another. Just like inside the Earth, electric currents are also created in the atmospheric realm and the intervening space between Earth and Sun. Any electromagnetic changes in these layers are recorded at magnetic observatories.
About 90% to 95% of the Earth's magnetic field originates from the interior processes, which are long-term, whereas the solar component is a short-term component. So it's an interplay between the short and the long-term components that manifests as the observed geomagnetic field.
How exactly do observatories tap into magnetism of Earth and Sun? There are two kinds of magnetic data to measure. The absolute value of Earth's magnetic force at any given location and any variations or anomalies in Earth's magnetism at any given location. The most basic instrument to measure that is the flux gate magnetometer. IIG has built an array of magnetic observatories throughout the length and breadth of the country to record and study these field changes. To monitor seismotectonic activities, observatories at Shillong, Silchar, Rajkot, Port Blair was established. Gulmarg, Jaipur, Nagpur, Vishakhapattanam and Pondicherry were established at different period of time to study different space and geomagnetic activities. To study all space-related phenomena, Trivendram Magnetic Observatory was shifted to Tirunelveli. To study ionosphere through MF radar and other techniques, Kolhapur unit of IIG started. To understand the longitudinal difference in SQ current system, Allahabad Magnetic Observatory was established. The magnetic data recorded at all the observatories is stored and disseminated globally through the World Data Center established at IIG and is the only such center in South Asia.
Kolhapur, Alibag together form a magnetic field data set which is one of the world's treasures because it's a long uninterrupted data set which can throw light on the slowly varying part of the Earth's magnetic field.
The magnetic data spanning almost two centuries has revealed seasonal, periodic and sunspot effects on geomagnetic elements, and secular variation showed the waxing and waning of magnetic field intensity. The array of magnetic observatories has helped understand the mechanism and effects of solar quiet and EEJ currents.
Modern society is every day becoming more and more dependent on space-based facilities. You see, our navigation, our satellite communication, resource surveys, and everything and day to day, our mobile network, we are dependent on space technology. And because of this, the new branch of science has come as a space weather.
Space weather describes magnetic storms that take shape in the magnetosphere with the potential to impact life and technology. The tumultuous space processes are recorded on the magnetograms as in top and the quiet conditions as in bottom. The growth of technology has put society at risk from space weather. The specter of space weather looms large not just over high latitude countries but also mid latitude countries like India. IIG is putting all efforts to keep track of changes whirling around in the dark reaches of the space. Globally, the space weather studies got a big boost when IIG scientists found that space weather and meteorological weather may be connected through a coupling between the magnetosphere and the ionosphere. IIG is using its treasure trove of magnetic data to develop numerical simulation codes to help investigate the processes of energy, momentum, and mass transfer taking place between the solar wind and the magnetosphere across the magnetopause and their transport into the magnetosphere. The HPC facility at IIG is using simulation studies to understand magnetic storms, the magnetosphere-ionosphere coupling, generation mechanisms of magnetic pulsations, and their propagation to low latitudes, sunspot cycle duration, generation of geodynamic currents, magnetic reversals, climate models, and so on. The conductive layers attract magnetic field lines and resistive ones repel. Electromagnetic field lines reveal the interior structure of our planet, offering clues to understand structurally weak and mineralized zones. In fact, scientists at IIG have been mapping the magnetic and gravity anomalies of India and adjoining regions, unearthing many important geological and geotectonic features. IIG scientists study magnetic minerals to understand plate motions, changes in climate and environment, coastal processes related to erosion and deposition of sediments apart from the sea level changes, recurrence interval of earthquakes, magnetic field intensity changes, archaeomagnetism, and much more. Resistivity surveys have helped understand the extent of the intrusion of seawater seeping into freshwater bodies along the coasts. GPS is normally used to navigate a city or town, but geomagnetism scientists use it for very different reasons. The team of scientists from IIG is getting ready for a field visit to set up a GPS sensor to receive satellite data. The data will be used to monitor the density and compositional changes of the ionosphere. The other important use of GPS to monitor the relative movement along Earth's different surface and subsurface units. The long data series from Earth and space studies has revealed that the magnetosphere, ionosphere, lithosphere, and the magmasphere are dynamically coupled with one another. This insight is helping us understand the processes around earthquake activity. To know more about this exciting field of study, let's travel to the Shillong facility of IIG, the Shillong Geophysical Research Center, the state capital of Meghalaya. Shillong is a seismic prone area. The meandering gorges around the Shillong plateau point to seismic movements that are routine here. The active fault forces the Doki River near Shillong to take a linear path. The region is marked by crisscrossing fissures which bear witness to tremendous geotectonic activity in the past. The Geophysical Research Center Observatory is located near the fault, which is building up strain that can possibly be captured in the magnetic recordings. Comprehensive multi-parametric geophysical studies have been launched here under LAIM project to understand dynamical changes due to geotectonic movements in and around Shillong.
Firstly, let us understand what is happening at the time of earthquake occurrence. Then what happens just after the time of earthquake occurrence. How the ionosphere or the atmosphere is responding to some of the energy that is being input from the lithospheric realms, that is the nether worlds, and how the lithosphere itself is responding to this earthquake occurrence.
Vertical ground motion near earthquake epicenter oscillates the atmosphere, producing acoustic waves that rearrange ionospheric constituents, causing plasma depletion. Earthquakes thus leave their signatures both in the earth and in the atmospheric realm. Diverse teams of seismologists, upper atmosphere and ionosphere scientists from IRG are combining their expertise to predict earthquakes.
We understand space physics, we understand atmospheric physics, we understand to a good deal earth physics, earth interior physics. So most of the other institutions are at the either end of the spectrum, but we are placed somewhere in the mean of the spectrum. I think these two, this development of the integrated earthquake precursory signal system and decoding the drivers of sun processes of lower atmospheric origin and ionosphere with a bearing on climate change or climate variability. I think these two are done in the coming few years. That would be a fantastic contribution to both Indian and global science.
IRG has always ventured out from its comfort zones into unknown terrains to further the horizons of understanding natural processes. It made forays into one of the most uninhabited and mysterious places on the planet, Antarctica. It has been a very active participant in the National Antarctic Program, having far-reaching international implications. All the expeditions that were launched from 1981 onwards had strong IIG presence, where apart from major experiments conducted, it also provided leadership rudder for successfully navigating all the experiments from all the participating institutions to fruition. An IIG member was an integral part of the group that touched the geographic South Pole in 2010. One of the important experiments carried at Antarctica relates to Rheometer, which measures the intensity of cosmic radio noise by monitoring changes in the ionosphere. The Indian Antarctic Mission has given a rare opportunity to study the phenomenon of direct deposition of solar wind energy, global electrical circuit, changes in geomagnetic field at high latitudes, dynamics of cosmic radio noise absorption, glacier migration and aurorae. IIG is using its knowledge and expertise for the benefit of society by offering free or nominal fee consultancy. The compasses of Indian Navy and Air Force are calibrated at Alibag Observatory. Expertise is being provided to institutions like ISRO to calibrate payload magnetometers. Electromagnetic surveys are carried out for oil companies and other strategic sectors, including nuclear facilities and defense entities. Help is also provided to locate and exploit geothermal energy. IIG is also reorienting the runways of Indian airports, determining orthometric heights, ascertaining precise lat-long locations to measure the declinations, and finding locales of least magnetic gradients. Critically important for some sophisticated defense equipment are some of the other important services IIG has been providing.
This is the fault line 1, 2, 3. Thrice it is crossing the fault line.
To keep abreast of the developments in all the research areas, IIG conducts workshops and training programs for scientists and research scholars. The IIG library is an invaluable resource. Extensive literature, ranging from fundamentals to the cutting-edge advanced work happening in the field of geomagnetism and its allied areas, is available here. IIG's instrumentation section is at the forefront for providing the very latest technology to the scientists to probe the Earth and space with more sensitive and higher resolution instruments. IIG has patented indigenously built high resolution magnetometer. IIG has never shied away from taking on the responsibility of carrying out complex research of geomagnetic phenomena. The intricate web of knowledge many a times gets beyond the comprehension of policymakers and laity. As part of social responsibility, it reaches out to school and college students and teachers, as well as the common folk, to make them aware of the need for the complicated research. The benefits that accrue to society as a whole are also explained to them and policymakers. In absence of dedicated syllabi in almost all the Indian universities, the efforts launched by IIG to reach out to the masses assumes a lot of significance. This is how IIG's progression and evolution has been in the last two centuries, from an observational entity to a core research institution to one that has embraced the applied aspects in multiple domains. For IIG, this transformation has been a real challenge. IIG's pursuit of excellence in theoretical and research-based scientific work is what has helped it surmount this challenge. In the coming years, the Indian Institute of Geomagnetism, or IIG, an autonomous institute under Department of Science and Technology, would be directing its energies towards areas of applied research, and especially research that is relevant to society. Nature speaks to us in the language of waves. Scientists at IIG have enriched our understanding of this language, which is of crucial importance when it comes to protecting human lives, safeguarding space and earthbound technological infrastructure, as well as shaping the very future of these technologies.
The Department of Science and Technology is completing 50 glorious years in the service of the nation through science and technology. This journey of relevance and excellence has not been a solitary one. All our autonomous organizations have played a critical role in driving forth with quality and focus and speed in their respective areas. They have excelled in their pursuits. I wish all the autonomous organizations and their scientists a very successful future. The future is coming at us at faster and faster speeds. I'm sure you'll be fully prepared to meet the challenges and create new opportunities and work for an Atmanirbhar Bharat that can be proud of its S&T depth and spread.